Namaste to you everybody. I am Professor Venkatrama B.R. I welcome you all to this another video lesson. Eleanor is the educated, somewhat controlling mother of two imaginative boys, Eric and visually creative Bertie. Eleanor pushes her brother Harvey to buy and get her sons interested in civilian non-violent toys. What happens when the boys play with the new non-violent toys? Will the experiment show peace toys can influence the boys' interest? Check out what happens when you read Socky's The Toys of Peace. Hector Hugh Munro, better known by the pen name Socky and also frequently as H.H. Munro. He was a British writer who was witty, mischievous and sometimes deathly stories satirizes Edwardian society and culture. He is considered a master of short story and often compared to O. Henry and Dorothy Parker. He wrote many short stories and sketches. Besides his short stories, he wrote a full-length play called titled as The Watched Pot. He wrote the novels The Unbearable Bassington and When William Came. The characters in the short story The Toys of Peace. Let's get to know the characters. The first character, Eleanor, the mother of two children, namely Eric and Betty. Harvey Bob, brother of Eleanor. Eric, a boy of 11 years old. Betty, a creative boy of 9 and half years old. Background to the short story. The Toys of Peace is written by Socky H.H. Munro, who was a soldier and died in the war. The story was first collected in the 1919 anthology of the same title. Set in 1914, the story satirizes the campaign by the National Peace Council, a coordinating committee of anti-war organizations against violent toys. The story is narrated in third person by an unnamed narrator. The story writer in this extract shows how the war has deep impact on the young minds. The mind of younger generation is absorbed in the battle. They are obsessed with violence and action of war. Their mind is so affected that it is impossible to bring them back to normalcy. They find it strange if you want them to play with the toys of peace. The story. What exactly is the Toys of Peace about? What are some of the important events from the story? If you are curious about these questions, take a look at this lesson. This story centers around a man named Harvey and his sister Eleanor. They are the responsible adults and siblings, Eleanor and Harvey Bob. These siblings are close enough that they visit each other and they share similar ideas about children. Here in this first paragraph of the story, we come to know something about a newspaper cutting. Eleanor Bob shows her brother Harvey a newspaper cutting from a London morning paper of the 19th of March. The fact that she keeps on reading newspaper seems to be a clue she is educated and intelligent. It seems supported by the fact that she has spent time thinking about whether toys can influence how boys play. The newspaper cutting was about children's toys. She says that the paper carries out some of our ideas about influence and upbringing of children. The two read newspaper article about how war toys encourage violent behavior. It is reported that there are grave objections to presenting our boys with regiments of fighting men, batteries of gun, and squadrons of dreadnoughts. It says the National Peace Council wants to prevent children from getting addicted to the spirit of violence and bloodshed. The National Peace Council admits that the boys naturally love fighting and all the exhibition of war. The National Peace Council don't encourage the primitive instincts. So, they have designed a plan. The council will be exhibiting piece of toys at the children's welfare exhibition as alternatives to toys that promote violence. The council recommends giving them the toys of civilian figures with industrial toys instead of soldiers with guns. The children's welfare exhibition opens at Olympia in 3 weeks' time. The Peace Council, which will make an alternative suggestion to the parents in the shape of exhibition of peace toys. They want to introduce the toys of peace to children as now they are playing with the toys of war. The peace toys will be grouped in front of the specially painted peace palace at The Hague. There will be miniature civilians, clothes and tools of industry in the exhibition. The manufacturers of these peace toys are also instructed to take a hint from the exhibition so that it would be helpful for their toy shops. In the story, The Toys of Peace, we see a brother and sister trying to change the inclination of the two children from violence to peace. So, they decide to give Eleanor's kids figures of civilians to see how they like them. Eleanor's brother, Harvey, has come on a visit to his sister. Eleanor asks her brother to buy the toys of peace for her sons, Eric and Bertie. She wants to know whether they can bring the children back from their war spirit. Eleanor remembers that her aunt Susan brought them the toys of siege of Adrianople. Along with the toys, she sent the uniforms, flags, the names of the respective commanders. This had a great negative effect on the mind of the young children. They even used foul language while they playing the war. Eleanor overhears them using what she thinks is objectionable language while playing the siege of Adrianople toy. She takes the toy away even when the boys claim they were only using Bulgarian words of command. So, she expects from her brother Easter gifts to give quite a new impulse and direction. Children of Eleanor. We want to know something about the children of Eleanor here. Eric is 11 and Bertie is only 9 and a half. So, the children are at an impressionable age. Impressionable here means vulnerability or sensitive. He argues that interest in the war is genetic. Henry said that the primitive instinct and hereditary tendencies to be taken into consideration while thinking about the children. There are some examples of genetic interest in the war. One of their great uncles fought in a most intolerant fashion at Inkerman, and their great grandfather smashed all his Whig neighbors' hot houses when the reform bill was passed. But Harvey tells her, "I will do my best." True to the suggestion, on Easter Saturday, Harvey brings them different types of toys this time. Eric and Bertie watch in eager anticipation as their uncle unpacks a large box. Children expected Albanian soldiery and Somalia camel corps. Eric was in favor of the latter contingency because the Albanians have got jolly uniforms, fought day and night. They have got no cavalry as the country is rocky. The first item of Harvey's Easter gift is a featureless square building. The boy, Betty, thinks it is a fort, while another boy, Eric, believes it is an Albanian palace. Harvey tells them it is a municipal dustbin for garbage collection. Harvey wants to impress the boys with regard to the municipal dustbin. He mentioned that all the refuse and litter of a town is collected in the municipal dustbin instead of laying about and injuring the health of the citizens. He uncovered a little lead figure of a man in black clothes. He said that it is a distinguished civilian, a lead figure of the John Stuart Mill, the political economist. He uncovered a square building with windows and chimneys. It was a model of the Young Women's Christian Association, Manchester branch. Eric asked if there were any lions. Eric was reading Roman history and expected to find a few lions. Harvey showed a civilian figure of the Sunday school founder, Robert Reichs. He also gave model of a municipal wash house, little loaves baked in the sanitary bakehouse, sanitary inspector, district councillor, official of the local government board. He also gave them a ballot box. Votes are put into it at election times. There are a tools of industry such as a wheelbarrow, means a trolley, and a hoe, a model beehive, a sewer ventilator, the model of a school of art public library, little lead civilian figures of Mrs. Hemans, a poetess and Roland Hill, inventor of postage stamp, and Sir John Herschel, the astrologer, were also given. Harvey told them that these were toys they were meant to be played with. In this story, we come to know about the mention of the jolly game of election. Eric asks how they are supposed to play with the civilian figures. Harvey explains that they could hold an election with the figures. They might make two of them contest a seat in parliament. According to the children, one could make two people contest a seat in parliament with the rotten eggs and free fights and so many broken heads. The boys are excited to imagine bloody drunken fights. The boy suggests that the election transfers into a fight with broken skulls, rotten eggs being thrown, and bloody noses. Harvey tells them they cannot play like that with those toys. He quickly explains the election process. Harvey suggested that votes will be put in the ballot box and mayor will count them. He will say which has received the most votes. Then the two candidates will thank him for presiding. So the boys showed no interest in such kind of games. Due to the absence of enthusiasm in those jolly games, they decided to work on their holiday task of history homework. The boys mentioned that they will study something about the Bourbon period in France. Eric says that they have got to know about Louis XIV of France. He added that he already knows all the major battles fought during his reign. When the boys talk excitedly about the battles, Harvey tries to encourage them to think about the great gardeners of that period. Harvey's opinion about the battles fought during the reign of Louis XIV. But Harvey says that the accounts of the battles fought were much exaggerated. As there were particularly no war news correspondents, generals and commanders magnified every little skirmish they engaged. Harvey is quick to try and distract his nephews from the thoughts of Louis XIV bloody battles by pointing out the king was a famous gardener. Eric cites an example of Madame du Barry,
whose head was chopped off. Henry evasively called her another great lover of gardening. He adds that well-known Rose Dewberry was named after her. They left the children with those toys and waited outside to see how they fare with the new toys of peace. From here onwards, we come to know in this story Harvey's opinion about history for use in the elementary schools. While Harvey is alone, he thinks about what it would be like in the classroom if the topic of war was avoided. He wonders whether it would be possible to compile a history for use in the elementary school in which there should be no prominent mention of battles, massacres, murderers, conspiracies, and violent deaths. He admitted to himself that the York and Lancaster period and the Napoleon era would present considerable difficulties. The 30 Years' War would require something of a gap if you left it out altogether. He concludes that it would be something gained if children focus on the invention of calico printing instead of Spanish Armada or the Battle of Waterloo. After Harvey's alone time, he decides to go to check on the boys to see how they are doing with their new toys. He listens outside the door for a while as the boys describe how they can pretend all the civilian figures are soldiers and chiefs. The children knew nothing but war and violence. Presented with lead figures of notable civilians and other non-violent toys, the boys are at first unsure what to do and they lost interest. Children being resourceful, however, they soon find a way to combine the new toys with their history homework for entertainment. Harvey returns later to check on the boys and finds them playing. Using the new toys, they improvise all those things as tools of war. They have improvised a French invasion of Manchester. They create the story of Louis the 14th. Robert Reich, noted for promotion of Sunday schools, is now Louis 14th. The lady figure of poetess Mrs. Hemans became Madame de Maintenon. She begs Louis not to go on this expedition, but it turns a deaf ear. Eric says that Louis takes Marshal Saxe with him and they have thousands of men with them. The watchword is Kiwi. Harvey observed that the municipal dustbin had been pierced with holes to accommodate the muzzle of imaginary cannon and now represented the municipal fortified position of the Manchester. John Stuart Mill had been dipped in red ink and apparently stood for Marshal Saxe. Other civilian figures are being used to represent the soldiers and the casualties. Louis orders his troops to surrender the Young Women's Christian Association and seize a lot of them. The soldiers attacked in revenge the Young Women's Christian Association and abducted the girls. They dragged 500 girls to the French ship. After hundreds of girls have been killed, J.S. Mill in the part of Marshal Saxe is stabbed by one of the girls. Bertie splashes red ink over YMCA building to illustrate the bloody death of Marshal. This way, the children had converted all peace toys into the instruments of war. Harvey, who observed all this peeping through the doors, was disillusioned. The boys modified all the toys of peace into the toys of war. He says that it is too late to change the mindset of the children. Harvey goes to his sister and declares the experiment a failure. The end of the story is also interesting as both Harvey and Eleanor appear to admit defeat when it comes to what type of toys the boys like to play with. Though Harvey considers that it may have been too late to change the boy's mind, that is not certainty. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, make sure to subscribe for more videos.